Hello, everyone. My name is Dan Restrepo, and I'm the Associate Residency Program Director for Point of Care Ultrasound in the Department of Medicine at Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston. Thank you so much for joining me. We're going to be talking about lung ultrasound today, and we're going to start out with our first installment where we're going to cover basic principles, probe selection, anatomy, and lung zones. So by the end of this talk, I will have been successful if you can list the basic principles of lung ultrasonography, choose the correct probe based on indication, and recognize normal anatomy on lung ultrasound. So let's go ahead and get started. In general, if you were to go back and read an internal medicine textbook from 25 or 30 years ago, they'd tell you that ultrasounding the lung is a waste of time because it's an air-filled organ, and air is inherently the enemy of ultrasound since it does not conduct sound waves very efficiently. Actually, when we do ultrasound the lung, most of what we're looking at are artifacts. We're gonna go through a lot of what these mean, but things like A lines, B lines, and consolidation all are actually artifactual products of the gas-solid interface that happens in the chest. I wanna convince you that lung ultrasound, though, is portable. It's a sensitive and dynamic tool that can vastly change a diagnostic picture really, really quickly, and I actually am a huge fan of it. But it is important to remember that all of the findings that we're going to discuss in this series have a differential diagnosis. They're not pathognomonic for anything, and they're part of a larger clinical picture, and that is something that is worth always keeping in mind. So what probe are we going to use when we start ultrasounding the lung? And really, the answer depends on what we're looking for. But in general, the probe indicator is always going to be towards the patient's head. And again, the probe that you choose is depending on what you're looking for. And if in the case of something very sort of fine or diminute like a pneumothorax, you would be using the linear probe. Or with regards to other pathology, we're often using the curvilinear or the phased array probe in cart-based machines with several probes. Most of the time, the patient is supine. They can be laying flat or they can be at an angle because the majority of what we're actually looking for can be found in the anterolateral lung zones. At times, we'll often go into the posterior views to look more carefully for pneumonia. And in general, it's a good principle to always think about aiming the probe perpendicular to the pleura so that the sound is actually hitting the pleura at a 90-degree angle and we can get the best picture possible. That's important to note. That's not always perpendicular to the chest wall. In general, if you're going to be using probes that have presets, the lung preset actually allows or amplifies a lot of these artifacts, where if you're using another modality, like the abdominal modality on a curvilinear probe, those modalities are designed to drown out the artifacts at the gas-solid interface. So it's important to always remember to have your machine on the lung preset. Okay, transitioning over to anatomy and the scanning zones. And so in general, we're going to be looking at the lung through the chest. And we have here an awesome schematic from Dr. Soni's great point of care ultrasound book. And really what we're trying to get through is this section here, this cross section of the chest wall, which you'll see in several schematics in the rest of the talk. And really we're kind of insinuating the probe from the anterolateral fields predominantly, as I said earlier. And so if you were to take a CT scan, the majority of kind of what we're looking at in this sagittal cut is sort of to scan the lung like that using the ultrasound probe. Okay, and as I mentioned earlier, a lot of what we're gonna be looking at is sort of the view of the lung as seen through the chest wall. And here in this schematic, I have kind of a cross section of the chest wall with a rib and a rib in the dark gray, the sort of soft tissue of the intercostal space in the light gray. And in theory, visceral and parietal pleura are going to be apposing themselves in that yellow line with that dark blue being hopefully healthy air-filled lung. Now, it's important to note that the ribs are largely calcific and dense, and thus they do not let sound through them. So there should be some shadows behind those ribs. And this is gonna be a frequent thing that we'll be coming back to throughout our talk. And so in general, there's actually a variety of protocols to how to scan the lung. I typically find most utility in the Volpicelli lung zones, named so after the author of a seminal study in 2006. And this study divides actually, or this protocol divides the chest into 8 zones, 4 per hemithorax. And you can see we try to have the divisors of said zones be the parasternal region, the anterior axillary line, and the posterior axillary line. And as I said, this then divides the chest into 8 different scanning zones. And the nomenclature can vary from place to place. The one that I like to keep in my mind is the right zones start up with 1R, 2R, 3R, and 4R as you move further down the chest. And on the left side, it would be 1L, 2L, 3L, and 4L as you move down the chest. And as I said, many protocols exist, and it depends kind of on what you're looking for, but there can be as few as 4 zones and as many as 32. And it can also be tailored to the clinical question, meaning if, you know, if you're looking for a pneumothorax in a supine person, you really want to focus a lot on those upper zones. If you're looking for pleural effusions, you probably want to be spending a little bit more time down in the dependent regions of the chest. And with that, we conclude our first part of our talk on lung ultrasound. Please tune in to the next series for a total of 4 talks on lung ultrasound.